All right, y'all. Well, I want to welcome you to Calvary Church St. Charles campus this morning. As we get kicked off here this morning, we have a really big official announcement to be made. You may have seen it in an email or on social media this past week. But I want to welcome up to the stage right now our new worship leader, Andrew, and the rest of his family. If y'all want to come on up. Yeah. And Andrew, that's cool. You're good up here. So I'm terrible with names, so I'll let you introduce your family to everyone, and then what I want to do is I want to pray for you guys just for a fruitful ministry and future here. So, yeah.
All right. Good morning, Calvary.
Good morning.
I want to introduce my family. Of course, I'm Andrew Bethany, the new worship pastor here. I'm going to start with my wife first, of course. We have Ashley. Let's start from the top right here. Then we got my son, Arion. And then we have my four-year-old, Drew. And my one-year-old, Andra. Is there anything you would like to say to the people? Amen. All right.
All right. Awesome. All right. Sweet. Thanks, man. All right. So what we're going to do is we're going to pray for Andrew and his family in their future here. And so if y'all want to bow your heads and join with me, let's pray for them. Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you that through months of searching and praying and hoping for wisdom and discernment that you have brought to us our next worship leader. And Lord, it's been hard to be patient, and yet, Lord, your promises are true, and you never fail us. And so we're trusting in you that in this next season for our church, for our campus, that you would use Andrew and Ashley and their family in mighty ways at this campus, that you would bless them, that you would protect their family from any attacks from the enemy, from any attacks outside these walls, and that as he leads us in worship to praise and glorify your name, that you would also continue to pour into him and his family, that they would feel encouraged, that they would feel loved, that they would feel like this is their family, their new family here, their church family at this campus. And so, Lord, I pray that as a community, we can not literally, but figuratively, like bring our arms around them and welcome them in the best possible way, and that you would use him in mighty ways at our church. And we pray this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Hey, thank you guys so much. All right, can we give this one last hand? Yeah, welcome. I want to invite you guys to stand. Jaren is going to lead us in worship. And before we start, I want us to give a thank you to Jaren because he, like Rachel, has been an amazing interim for us. Like, you have been there through the thick and thin of it all this summer and this early fall, ever since we reopened. You've been a massive blessing to our campus, and so we've loved that you've been there. So can we give Jaren a big hand that he's been helping us out for so long? All right, I'm going to turn it over to Jaren, and let's worship our God.
Well, church, it has been awesome. We are so rejoicing with you that you guys have found Andrew and his family to be here with you guys, to have a home. What do you guys sing as we praise the name from the rising of the sun to the ending of the day? From the rising of the sun to the ending of the day. Heights and from the depths, all creation lifting up, we sing your name. Your name alone be praised, and we sing praise, Lord. Oh, praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth, bless his name. Jesus. Jesus, you have rescued us. You are good and you are just. One name alone be praised from the heights. From the heights and from the depths. In every heart with every breath. Your name alone we raise, we sing praise, praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth. Bless His name, only one name, now and always we sing praise, praise the God, sing praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth. Bless His name, only one name, now and always. Oh, praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth. Bless His name. His name this morning, amen.
So I want to ask you to now have a seat, because we're going to do something a little different here this morning than we usually do. And if you've noticed, under seats is a little kind of cardstock piece of note and also a pen. And so hopefully you have one of those under your chair. And what we're going to do this morning, as we kick off our new series, Knowing Jesus, is we want to take a moment together while Jaron kind of leads us in our next song of who do we think Jesus is, all right? So as we sit here today, who do we think Jesus is? Who is Jesus to us? What are some of the characteristics? What are some of the attributes? What are some of the things that we think, man, this is like definitely Jesus through and through. This is what I think. This is what I think of Jesus. This is my relationship to Jesus. And so we want to write these down. And what we want to do, yeah, don't be embarrassed, Andrew. Steal that pen. Yeah, get it. Yeah, you're good. So what we want to do is we want to hang on to these to the very end of the series. And so as we walk through this series of Knowing Jesus, we want to see, is what we thought of Jesus at the very beginning of the series, is that what we think of Him at the end? Or maybe the way in which we think of Jesus has changed. Maybe it's been reaffirmed. Maybe it's been shaped in a different way. And so this is going to be a pretty long series for us. I told you last week, we're going till April with this. Like, we're chronologically going through the entire life of Jesus. And so, like, Easter's going to line up, and then we have a Sunday or two after Easter, and that's where we're in. So we want to take a moment, fill these out, hang on to them, slip them in your Bible, slip them into your planner, slip them into your journal, hang on to them, and then we're going to see how did God work and move and shape us in our relationship with Jesus through this series, and hopefully we see growth by the end. So I'm going to turn it over to Jaron. He's just going to play some music for us to kind of give us some time to think and interact with this, and then we'll continue worship in a little bit. Thank you.
I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. 'Cause you are Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Touching every heart, I worship you. I worship you. Yes, you are here, God, you're healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're mending every heart. And I worship you. God, I worship you.
Would you stand as we sing, Waymaker?
Promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. We declare you are Waymaker, Waymaker, miracle work. Promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Yes, and that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
And even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop.
Oh yeah, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop. Oh, Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Oh, and that is who you are. That is who you are. Yes, that is who you are. Oh, that is who you are. And that is who you are. That
is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. One more time we sing, Waymaker. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God.
This morning, we lift up a shout of praise for who you are, Lord God. Please keep revealing to us who you are. Please keep revealing to us how you are here with us, moving in our midst. Lord God, we are here for you to hear your word. Lord God, it's such a blessing to join together with one voice. To sing out our testimony. Oh God, we are attentive to your spirit. We're attentive to your word. We're attentive to you, Jesus. We thank you. We are grateful in your great name that we pray all these things together. United, we say amen. Amen. You guys go and have a seat.
Well, today we are starting a brand new series called Knowing Jesus, and we're going to be walking together, like I said a little bit earlier, chronologically through the life of Jesus. So we're going to mostly be in the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but mainly we may not even go by verse order, but more so chronological order. Now, before we get to that, though, what we need to do is we need to kind of address, okay, where are we really entering into the story of the Bible? Before we hit the ground running with the life of Jesus, like, what is the story? What is the narrative? What is the space? What is the context in the culture that Jesus is stepping into when he comes to earth? And so we're going to look today a little bit at some of the Old Testament prophecy, the preparation, the predictions of, hey, there's this Messiah coming and don't miss it. And our hope that at the end of this series, which is going to take us through April, we as the gathered people of God would experience Jesus in a fresh way and would know him on a deeper level than we do today, that over the next coming months, we would grow together in deep ways. Now, I think this series comes to us at a perfect time for a couple of reasons. One of them is that there are tons of misunderstandings about Jesus in our culture. And especially in the midst of the election year and other things going on in our culture, it seems that Jesus is weaponized more and more by the day. And there's a bunch of counterfeit Jesuses in our cultures. There's a bunch of misunderstandings about the Jesus of the Bible. And I'm not entirely sure if all the time the Jesus we're interacting with is actually the Jesus in the Bible, or it's Jesus that we have crafted in the image of ourselves. And so throughout this series, we're going to be digging into, okay, who is the Jesus in the Bible? How do we unabashedly, unapologetically dig into who he is, why he was sent here, what his mission is, and as we try to strip away all the pretense or maybe the things that we've imported into the meaning of Jesus, because maybe the Jesus that we've been trying to follow and the Jesus in the Bible aren't the same. Or maybe they are the same, and we need to be re-encouraged and reinforced and re-reminded of how beautiful and true and good Jesus is. And so our task here at Calvary Church, St. Charles Campus, as we embark on this series, is not necessarily to reinforce what we already know, although that may happen, and that may be good, and that may be healthy for us, but we don't really want to filter Jesus, right? Like, we want to come to the text, we want to come to the scriptures and approach it in a way in which we aren't diluting the Jesus we see in the Bible. And so our task as we move through the series is to know the Jesus of the Bible, to experience the Jesus of the Bible, and then to live like the Jesus of the Bible. So with that being said, we're going to kick off the series today by establishing two things. I think two things we really need to do to lay the groundwork, to lay the foundation for where we're going to be going throughout this entire series is, one, is we need to locate God in the story. Where is God at work? How was he working through the people of God, even in the Old Testament, leading up to the birth of Jesus? And then how did God work through the birth of Jesus? And also, we need to locate ourselves in the story. So where do we fit into the bigger story that's bigger than just our own individualistic story? So we need to locate God in the story, and then we need to locate ourselves in the story. And if we can do both those things, then I think it's going to lay really good foundation and really good groundwork for where we're going to be going for the rest of our series. And so let's start with that first one. Let's locate God in the story. How did he work and move and shape and predict the coming of the Messiah? And so one thing to keep in mind as we dig into this that's going to be really important is that we see God the Father, he's sending his son. It's not a last-minute buzzer beater. It's not a last-ditch effort. It was planned. It was predicted from the beginning. And I would argue we can't fully grasp the magnitude of Jesus' birth if we neglect the Old Testament in the story that culminates in the birth of Emmanuel, God with us. And so we can't just jump into the middle of the story if we don't know where we're at. So just to give an example of this, you guys may experience this on a regular basis. You may have a friend or a family member or someone you know that, like, you're watching a movie, you're watching a TV show, right? And they come halfway through and start watching it with you, and about the first 10 things out of their mouth are, oh, who's that? Oh, who's that character? Oh, what's happening here? Oh, is that the guy that did this one thing? No, that's a different movie. That's not even this movie, right? So sometimes, right, that can be infuriating. It's like, okay, if you would have been here from the beginning, I wouldn't have to answer these 20 questions about this movie to you, all right? It's like, stop being a Karen in this moment, please. And so we, as we dig into this passage, we do not want to say, okay, we're coming in halfway through and we have no clue what happened. We have no clue what led up to the birth of Jesus and why he came and what his mission is. No, we want to have a good fleshed out idea of this is why he's coming. And so we're going to start with the first one, the prediction of a Savior. Genesis 3:15, the prediction of a Savior. If you have your Bibles with you, if you want to follow along, I invite you to do that. We're also going to put it up on the screen. If you're watching, as most of you are online right now, I want to invite you, maybe pause the video, have a kid in your family read out the passage so they can get familiar with the Bible. Maybe you take a moment just to read through that together at home. And here we go, Genesis 3:15. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. And so a few things here. Even though we don't have time for it this morning, we need to remember that Genesis 1 is actually the beginning of the Bible, not Genesis 3. So all things were created good and beautiful and true in the garden. There was this scene called Shalom where everything was kind of at perfect harmony. But that gets shattered in Genesis 3 because we see Adam and Eve and they fall and sin enters into the world. And it doesn't mean that goodness and beauty and truth are stripped away from our world. But what it does mean is they now have a next door neighbor. And that next door's neighbor is now sin. And so this brings in enmity. This brings in strife. This brings in division. This brings in hatred. This brings in a whole plethora of things. And so now we've got goodness and beauty and truth. They survived Genesis 3. Make no mistake about it. But now they've got a neighbor. And unfortunately, that neighbor is sin. And so God's first response, though, is interesting, is to tell the serpent of his defeat before he tells Adam and Eve of their consequences and the pains of childbirth, and the pains of tilling the soil, and all the things that are going to come after because of the fall. He actually addresses the serpent first. He says, hey, here, look, buddy, you think you've got victory by introducing sin and death into the world, but you're going to, in the cross, bruise the Messiah's heel, and in the empty tomb, your head is going to be crushed. And so we see from Genesis 3, there's already a prediction of a conquering Savior. And so even in humanity's darkest hour, there is mercy and there is grace and there is provision from God because he addresses the serpent. He addresses Satan right there, right off the bat. Hey, you think you've won, but you haven't. And I promise that I'm going to make this come to fruition. Now, I think this is a really good just kind of life application for us as the church, as the covenant people of God, that we see God in humanity's arguably darkest hour in the fall where sin enters, there's mercy and grace and provision. And what if as a people of God, we said, as we bear the image of God and we want to do that more and more truly each and every day that we live, what if in our darkest hours of our culture, of our society, of our lives, that we were a voice of grace and kindness and mercy? See, I think we've got a big problem in our culture right now, and it's kind of culminated in this thing called cancel culture. Are y'all familiar with this? Raise your hand if you're familiar with, like, cancel culture. Okay, I see some hands, I see some few notes. So cancel culture is basically say, like, if you step out of line, if you do something that is not in line with what the general society at large, especially on social media and in the media, is holding to be a value, then we're going to disown you, right? Like, we're not, like, you can unfriend me on Facebook, see you later. Like, I'm not going to follow you anymore. Like, we are basically going to shame you into oblivion because you made this one mistake. It's graceless. It is completely graceless. And so I'm not saying when people do evil things, we don't call it evil. But also, maybe as a people of God, we should be the one stepping into that space and say, hey, in a world full of cancel culture that is shaming everyone into oblivion when they mess up and their mistakes are put on a big screen in front of the world, maybe we're the ones that step in and say, hey, we're going to be kind, we're going to be gracious, we're going to be merciful. Why? Because we want to bear the image of God in the best way we can. And so as negative as cancel culture is, and as sad as it is, it actually provides an excellent opportunity for the church to step into that space and show grace and mercy where there is hardly any. Now, Satan's intention here is that there would be enmity between Adam and Eve. So God, he flips the script and says, actually, the ultimate enmity will be between her offspring and you. And so at the cross, you will be defeated. In the empty tomb, victory will resound. And so we see God flips the script in Genesis 3. Satan's intention was, I'm going to drive a wedge between Adam and Eve, and I want to fracture humanity. And God says, hey, wait a minute, not so fast. Actually, the enmity is going to be between you and her offspring, and he's going to win. And so in Genesis 3, we see there's actually some good news after all in a pretty bleak chapter of the Bible. The good news is that a Savior is predicted and promised so that the events of the fall will not have the final say. And in a world of broken people, of brokenness, of broken systems, right? Like, that is truly great news. So the first thing we see, the prediction of a Savior. What's the second thing we see? We see a king promised. Isaiah 9, 6 through 7 says this, "For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and uphold it with justice and righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this." So this is written roughly 700 to 750 years prior to the birth of Jesus. And now it's kind of hard for us to get our minds wrapped around, like, okay, what really changes 700, 750 years? How much in advance truly is that in the grand scope of, like, human history? But just to kind of give us a handle on it, 750 years ago, roughly, the Renaissance was happening in Italy, and what we now call Mexico City was the capital of the Aztec Empire, all right? If y'all have ever been to Mexico, okay, those are ruins now, all right? Like, they've been long gone. So this is a long way before Jesus ever comes on the scene embodied, Emmanuel, God with us. And so that's the kind of rough timeline we're working with, and what God is promising at a fundamental level is a king far greater than David, right? Because after Adam and Eve fall, God eventually raises up a nation, a group of people that will proclaim his name to the nations, to be a light to the nations. They will live in a different way than the rest of the world. And he raises up Abraham and his family. And eventually, this nation grows into a massive people group in Egypt, and God frees them from Egypt. They wander in the desert for a while because of their disobedience, but eventually he brings them to the promised land of Canaan. And out of that, the kingdom of Israel is formed, and David winds up being the second king of that kingdom. If you're familiar with David and Saul, right, the people are like, we want a king. God's like, y'all don't want a king. It's not going to work. They're like, no, we want a king. So they get Saul, and guess what? Saul sucks. He's a terrible king. And so then David is raised up in that moment, and David, even though he had plenty of shortcomings, actually winds up being what we would say the best king of Israel, right? He was a God after man's own heart. But even David has his shortcomings, right? And so God says, okay, here's the thing. David was all right, but I'm going to promise you a king of an everlasting kingdom with no shortcomings. And he's going to reign and rule over you, but it's not going to be oppressive. It's not to your detriment. This king will reign in a way in which your lives flourish and that you feel the full and true love of God. Because no matter how great a leaders we have, David was a great one. We just got done with a series on Ezra and Nehemiah. Ezra and Nehemiah were great leaders. Even the best leaders cannot fix the deepest broken places of our hearts. They can't. Because at the end of the day, they're still human. They're still subject to the fall in the same ways we are. But this new king, this everlasting king, this king who ushers in a kingdom not with massive walls and populations and capitals and armies, but he ushers in an eternal kingdom that's not of this world, and this will solve the broken places in the deep parts of our hearts. And so God says, from the line of David, there will be a king greater than David. He'll sit on the throne of David and rule not over only Israel, but the nations. And friends, this is great news because guess what? We are the nations, right? Like sometimes we have a very individualistic, American-centric view of the world, but like we are the ends of the earth to these people, right? Like Israel is a long way away. That is a long plane ride. And so when they talk about the Gentiles, when they talk about the nations, that's us. Like the gospel has traveled across oceans and over mountains and over rivers, and it has reached us here in St. Charles, Missouri. Like we are the nations, and so this is great news. But God knows that even on Israel's best day, there's drift from faithfulness to the covenant. So God the Father, through his Son, is going to establish this eternal kingdom where the prodigals and the nations will be called home to worship. So here's what we've seen so far. We've seen the prediction of a Savior. We've seen the promise of a king. And Isaiah's also going to offer us up a kind of twist to the story, a servant who suffers. Isaiah 53, 4 through 6 says this, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteem him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. And like sheep we have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." So we see the Savior predicted, the King promised, and now we also see that this King, this Savior, is a sufferer. He suffers on the behalf of others. He's struck down so that others are healed. He's the new and permanent sacrificial lamb that will be substitute for our sin. I think I've mentioned this before. We'll go off notes here for a little bit. How many of you guys have seen Hunger Games? Like some of you guys have seen Hunger Games or read the books. The movie's a little bit older now. Okay, the Hunger Games, in my opinion, has the clearest picture almost of substitutionary atonement in any modern like media, right? So we have this scene where Katniss, the main character, they have this lottery system to go to this like horrible game, and her little sister's name gets drawn. And so she's thinking, hey, if my little sister has to go into this like battle arena thing, like there's no way she's surviving. Like she's going to get killed. And so Katniss says, hey, I'll go in place of my younger sister. All right? So clear as day, substitutionary atonement. That's what happens with Jesus on the cross, right? Like in our place, Jesus says, hey, they can't hack it. They can't defeat sin and death on their own. It's too big for them. He says, I'll go in their place. Send me. And so we see this servant who suffers, and it turns the paradigm of what the people think on their head, because they think a conquering king who's going to conquer with the military, and we see a suffering servant who conquers with his own death in the most ironic twist of events that the world has ever seen. And so their expectations were often fraught with, hey, Jesus, you can't go to the cross, right? Like, we see the scene where Peter actually tells Jesus, no, not you. Like, you're not going to the cross. And Jesus is like, no, Peter, I have to go. I have to suffer these things, and I'm going to rise again. And Peter's like, no. Just no, Jesus. And Jesus' response is, get behind me, Satan. Not very kind words, right? And so we see they're still struggling with that. Even the disciples are struggling that late in Jesus' ministry. They're expecting this king to come in with military power, not a sacrificial life. So God not only promises a king far greater than David, but this king then sacrifices for everyone else. He becomes the perfect priest, the perfect sacrifice that replaces the old covenant, and it ushers in a new covenant where mercy and grace and forgiveness abound. So just a short recap. In the Bible, in the story of humanity, we see that there's Savior predicted, King promised, a servant who suffers on behalf of the world, and God is raising up this Messiah through the line of Mary, through the line of Abraham and Israel and David, and all along the way, we see God active in the story to bring redemption to his people. Adam and Eve bring sin into the world. God the Father decides to give his son up to defeat sin. The people of Israel want a king. Their kings fail them. So God promises a greater and truer king. The people neglect the covenant. They go worship false idols. And God promises a sacrifice to usher in a new covenant. So God is intertwined throughout the entire story, and we see the culmination of the story in the person of Jesus, who is our redemption. So we've located God in the story. We know why Jesus is coming on the scene. So where do we fit in the story? Where is our role in this story? Well, I want to read John 1, 1 through 18 for us. Hopefully you follow along. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him, and without him was not anything that was made. In him was life, and life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as in from the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks before me, because he was before me. For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God, who is at the Father's side. He has made him known. So what is John saying here in the introductory part of his book, of his gospel? Well, to understand what John is saying, we need to understand the people he's writing to. Now, Jews would have been reading this gospel, but Gentiles, Greeks, are the primary audience, right? Like, this is written, it's translated into the Greek for the people. And it's a good place to remind us, like, sometimes we've got some cultural work to do to understand the Bible, right? Because the Bible, it's written for us, but it's not written to us. Are y'all tracking with that? I know I want to keep kind of getting us into that. Like, it's written for us, for the church, eternally, but, like, we aren't the original recipients, right? Like, we're not living in the first century. We're 2,000 years later. So it's not written to us, but it is written for us. And when John uses the word word, this Greek word is logos. So you may have heard this word before. And logos basically has a ton of baggage with it. So in the Greek word, this logos, this word, was kind of the culmination of reality for them. So all these Greek philosophers who were super smart dudes, they were looking for this thing that held the universe together. They were looking for this thing that was behind the natural world they saw. They were searching for this thing that basically tied all their reality together. And for the longest time, they couldn't understand it. They couldn't get a grasp on it. And so they said, hey, we don't really know what this thing is. It's just kind of this thing floating out there, but we're going to give it a name, and we'll give it logos. And this thing, whatever this is behind all of creation. This is behind all the natural world. This is behind everything that we see and feel and hear and touch. And they came up with this term. And this logos, for the most part, was an impersonal force. So it wasn't embodied. It wasn't something you had a relationship with. This was an impersonal force that you just tried to study and maybe learn about if you could. You tried to get your mind wrapped around it. And so when John writes in verse 14, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth," here's what John is saying. This thing that you've been searching for your whole lives, this logos, this thing you haven't been able to get a handle on, all right, this is Jesus, and he has come embodied. And it's no longer this thing that you can't see, feel, hear, or touch. No, this is Jesus embodied, incarnate. He has come. He is, we was there at the beginning when all things were created. He holds all things together. He brings all people together. And so this is the premise of John's entire argument. This thing that you have sought and you've never been able to find, it was Jesus. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. And so the God of the universe has come in the manger. He has lived among us, and he has died for us. And this is what the New Testament writers, again and again, as they spread the good news of Jesus throughout the Roman Empire, throughout the Greek-speaking world, they're saying, hey, this thing that you have longed for in your hearts, it was right in front of you. And you may have missed it while he was walking here on the earth, but don't miss it now. And so I want to end our message today, our time together today in the Word, with just kind of a call to action for us. Because even though we're not in the first century and we're not Greek-speaking, we're not in the Roman Empire, we're not hearing these arguments about what logos is, I do think we're confronted with the same question. Because we've all been longing for deep purpose and meaning and things in our life, and maybe we've been looking in all the wrong places. Maybe we've been trying to find purpose and meaning and belonging in our lives in the places that can't supply it, in material things, in other people, or in our own personal greatness. And I think we're faced with the same question the first century church was. This thing that you've been searching for out there, and you're not going to find it out there, would you see that it's here? Would you see that it's in the person of Jesus? And so any non-Christians in the room, any non-Christians watching online, I want to talk to you guys for a second. Maybe like the Greeks, you have looked everywhere for the thing that is going to bring your life meaning and have yet to find it. Maybe you've tried to find meaning in other people. Maybe you've tried to find your ultimate meaning in who you are, your own identity that you're shaping and trying to cultivate yourself. And yet, the deepest meaning and purpose escapes you. Here's my challenge to you. Maybe you weren't so far off in looking for it in a person. Maybe you were just looking at the wrong person. Maybe the God-man of Jesus is the person you need to give a shot. You need to give him a chance. And so maybe your wiring was inclined to search in a particular way. It's just the bullseye was wrong. The target was wrong. And I encourage you, take that risk if that's a risk for you. Take that step if that's a hard step for you and give it a chance. Now, to the Christians in the room, to the Christians watching online, maybe over the years, Jesus has become this kind of impersonal force for you. You believe he's out there somewhere, but because of hurt or routine or busyness or burnout, you don't experience him in fresh or deep ways anymore. I have two challenges for you. One, that you would pray that during this series, you would experience and encounter Jesus in a new and fresh way, that he would bring revival to your life. And number two, that you wouldn't be content with anything less than a personal relationship with Jesus. Do not be content with this idea of an impersonal force floating around out there, judging you, condemning you, this kind of Zeus-like God picture, right? No, do not be content with that. So pray for the realness and growth and depth in your own life, and don't be content. Don't settle with an impersonal relationship because it will not sustain, and burnout is the only result that's going to be inevitable at that point. So that's my two calls to action. That's my two big challenges for us, believer or not. And I pray that as we move throughout the rest of this series and we dig into knowing Jesus and truly who he is, the Jesus we see in the Bible, the Jesus we want to experience, and the Jesus that we want to live like for the sake of our homes, our city, our community, our church family, and our world, that we would take this call to action series, that we'd pray about it, that we take it in earnest. And as a church family, as a covenant people of God, as the gathered people of God, we would look in April more like Jesus than we do today. Let's pray. Lord, Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful day that you have blessed us with. Thank you for your word. Thank you that we get to submit ourselves to it and learn from it, that it shapes our hearts, our minds, and our hands. And Lord, I ask that as we go throughout this series, maybe we would not be so stubborn with maybe some of the misconceptions that we've thought about Jesus, but we would see him in a new and a fresh way, Emmanuel, God with us. Lord, thank you for working in Adam and Eve's life, in Abraham's life, in Moses' life, in David's life, in Isaiah's life. Thank you for the prediction, the promises, the servant, fully blameless and holy, that suffered for us, a price that we could have never paid ourselves, on a hill that we could have never ascended ourselves, in a moment that was too big for us. You provided a hero for our story, and you took the weight off our shoulders, and you gave us new life, and you breathed purpose and meaning into us. Lord, we thank you for this. And so, Lord, give us sharp minds. Give us soft hearts. Give us active hands as we try to grow in our knowledge, our love, and our practice of what it means to be a disciple of Jesus, a follower of Jesus. Would your spirit go before us? Would you encourage us when we stumble, when you pick us up? And will we know that even in our darkest moments, you provide, you're the great provider, and grace and mercy is waiting for us, even in the most vulnerable moments of our lives. And we thank you so much for that, Lord. We pray this in Jesus Christ's name.
Amen. Would you stand as we sing? We sing out that he is worthy.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe. You are worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. There is there's none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and
send us out of here with our benediction this morning. And how we roll here at Calvary Church St. Charles Campus is we just kind of raise our hands in an open posture of receiving, and we ask God to send us out well. Lord, Heavenly Father, would you send us out well into our Monday, into our work week? Lord, would we be salt and light in the places we work, in the places we play, in the places we live? Lord, would we be an impact on our community, on our city, and on our world? And Lord, would you help us to remember that we are going to find the deepest meaning, purpose, and relationship in you. And maybe we've been searching in all the wrong places, but help draw us near and help us be a voice in a life that would encourage others to draw near. So give us courage, give us boldness, send us out well, help us to live out of our identity of the people of God this week. And Lord, next weekend, would you bring us back, would you gather us back for another dose of encouragement in the body with our brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray this in Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen. Hey, y'all have a great rest of your Sunday, and we can go in God's grace, and we'll see you next Sunday online or in person. Have a good one.